Tina McRae here. Can you guys hear me?
Yes, you'll have to mute though, Tina. We're going live.
Okay, now I'm going to mute by pressing.
One day, when the glory comes, it will be
out there with you. But I want you to know tonight that we as a people will get to the promised land.
We will be sure, we will be sure.
Hands to the heavens, no man, no weapon formed against, yes, glory is destined. Everyday women and men become legends. Sins that go against our skin become blessings. The movement is a rhythm to us. Freedom is like religion to us. Justice is juxtaposition in us. Justice for all just ain't specific enough. One son died, the spirit is revisiting us. True and living, living in us. Resistance is us. That's why Rosa sat on the bus. That's why we walk through Ferguson with our hands up. When it go down, we woman and man up. They say stay down and we stand up.
I, Barack Hussein Obama.
I, Barack Hussein Obama. I, Barack Hussein Obama, do solemnly swear
that I will execute the office of President to the United States faithfully.
That I will execute
the office of President of the United States faithfully.
To the best of my ability.
And will to the best of my ability.
Preserve, protect, and defend.
Preserve, protect, and defend.
The Constitution of the United States. The
Constitution of the United States.
So help you God.
So help me God.
Congratulations, Mr. President.
Now the one.
Glory be to God. I claim the victory in the name of the Lord. Let's go.
But we'll fight on to the finish. And then when it's all done, we'll cry glory. Oh, glory. Oh, glory. We'll cry glory. Oh, glory.
Oh, Selma is now. For every man, woman, and child. Even Jesus got his crown in front of a crowd. They march with the torch, we gon' run with it now. Never look back, we done gone hundreds of miles. From dark roads, heroes, to become a hero. Facing the League of Justice, his power was the people. Enemy is lethal, a king became regal. Saw the face of Jim Crow under a bald ego. The biggest weapon. It's to stay peaceful, we sing. Our music is the cuts that we bleed through. Somewhere in the dream we had an epiphany. Now we right the wrongs in history. No one can win a war individually. It take the wisdom of the elders.
Nigga, we are in numbers, yeah, we can even the score. The year is 2020, let us make that clear. This the last generation they mess with fear. And when we get old, the stories will be on repeat. Fighting for our rights and mass and trying to keep 6 feet. With my hand in yours, we'll get our justice and peace. Fist up, it's time to come together on our own streets.
so we can be one.
Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, everybody. We welcome you to the Mount Nebo Virtual Worship Experience under the leadership of Dr. Johnny Melvin Green, Jr. We're excited this morning because Pastor has asked to join him on Zoom. The wonderful business owners of the Mount Nebo Church. We're excited for their major achievements. And so during this Black History Month, we celebrate the great things that are being done in the lives of our people. And at this time, we'll be led into worship by Trustee Natasha Danza.
Good morning. Good morning, Mount Nebo. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. I will exalt thee and magnify his holy name. Surely grace and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. To God be the glory for great things he has done and still doing in our lives at this great church we call Mount Nebo. We thank you for stopping by and sharing with us on this virtual experience. We encourage you to share and like our page. Amen. We will now have our scripture read by Sister Tina McCray and followed by prayer from Minister Troy Gortman. Sister Tina?
Sister Tina, can you unmute yourself, star 69, or just hit the unmute button? You might be having some difficulties with your line. Trustee Janice, can you prepare to read the scripture?
Hi, family. Can you hear me now?
Awesome. Thank you so much, Tina.
Can you hear me now, family?
Yes, baby. Go right ahead.
I'm having trouble.
Go right ahead. We can hear you.
Family, can you hear me now?
Yes, read the scripture, honey. Read the scripture.
Can you hear me?
Yes, read the scripture.
My video is just not coming through on the phone.
Okay, not a problem at all. Let me ask Trustee Janice, we have those difficulties. Can you read the 121st Psalm, please?
Yes, good morning. I'll be reading from Psalms 121 in the Amplified Version. I will lift up my eyes to the hills from which cometh my help. My help comes from the Lord, he who made heaven and earth. He will not allow your foot to slip. He who keeps you will not slumber. Behold, he who keeps Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. Bless the reading of the word to God's people. Amen.
Thank you, Lord, for the reading of scriptures. Thank you, Lord, for allowing us to be a part of today. We thank you, God, because we have breath in our body. We have activity of our limbs. God, we praise you because there's no other God before you. There's no God behind you. God, we thank you for the celebration of Black history. We thank you for how you carried our people through danger seen and unseen. We thank you, God, for laying hands on our lives that we come to the throne of grace humble. God, we thank you. We thank you for the gathering of Mount Nebo family. We thank you for the adopted children. because they are adopted. We are adopted because Jesus came in our lives. We are adopted, God, because you have made a plan to save us. So God, we say thank you for that. God, as we move on in this service, we ask that you anoint the homes that are participating. We ask that you bless the people who are visiting this Zoom to be blessed that you are still in their lives. For God, some people have walked away from you. Some people have denied you, God, but we are here to celebrate you because we have a history with you. We have a history, God, that we are overcomers. We have a history, God, that we are believers of Jesus Christ. And so, God, while we're going forward in this service, we pray for your hand of mercy to be upon us, for you to forgive us for our sins are many, God. God, we know that you are a loving God. We know that you have agape love for us. So, God, we say thank you, and we ask that you will bless our pastor as he come and brings the word, God, the word that comes from heaven, for heaven is a place, God. There's a place that where you dwell. There's a place, it's a place where Jesus is on the right hand of you. So, God, we praise you and we thank you. God, and we say to you, as we are in this moment in time, that you will look after the people who are in bereavement, that you will carry them to the throne of grace to pray, God, for a man shall always pray, God. God, we ask that you would touch their lips, you would touch their hearts. We ask that the Holy Ghost would lead them, that they'll pray the prayer of faith and not waver in faith. For Jesus says that Satan desires them, desires us, those who are adopted by you. So God, we praise you and we continue to bless your name, and we hope for the best for those who are going through bereavement. We thank you, we honor you, and we give your name the praise. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen, amen. We know sometimes we have a little technical difficulties, but we know God is in control. We know he's in the midst. So I thank you, Sister Janice, Trustee Janice House, for stepping in, and thank you for the prayer, Minister Gortman. We will now have our moment in Black history. Our theme has been how we got over. This morning, we will take a look at the music behind the movement. We have journeyed through slavery, civil rights, and this morning, we're going to take a look at the 70s and 90s. Music by our very own Deacon Craig Stagg.
Amen, amen. It's a blessing to be here. Blessing to be here. God bless all y'all. But you know what? I think we need a revolution. It's a lot going on out here.
Yes, sir.
And we gonna either stand up and fight,
reach up,
or we gonna lay down.
Yes, sir.
And let everything happen to us.
Yes, sir.
I don't know about that. But you know what? Here we go. Mother, mother, there's far too many of you crying. Brother, 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 there's far too many of you dying. You know we've got to find a way to bring some loving here today. Oh, Father, Father, we don't need to escalate. You see, war is not the answer. Only love can conquer hate. You know we've got to find a way to bring some loving here today. Oh, picket lines, picket signs. Don't punish me with brutality. Talk to me so you can see. Oh, what's going on? What's going on? Hey, what's going on? What's going on? Ooh. 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 Yeah. need a revolution out here. We need a revolution. We gonna stand up, we gonna be strong. Here we go. Even when we go too much, we do too much. Then you lose, you ain't too much. Ain't no stopping what we doing when the spirit is moving. Don't be hating what I'm doing, I'm the best in these using. Everywhere I be, they try to judge me. They try to shake me, they try to budge me. But they can't break me, cause I'm down with Christ. Craig Stagg, let's team, son. That's right. Hey, everybody hands up. Everybody hands up. Millennials, hands up. Deacons, hands up. Trustees, hands up. Preacher, hands up. All my reverends, hands up. Let's go. Hey, put your hands up. Where my saints at? Come on now. Put your hands up. Where my millennials at? Hey, put your hands up. Here we go. Where my elders at? Mother, mother. Everybody thinks we're wrong. What? But who are they to judge us? Just because your hair is long. You know we've got to find a way to bring some loving here today. Picket lines, picket signs, honestly with food. Hey, God bless y'all. Be blessed. We need a revolution. We're going to stand up. We're going to fight for our rights. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen, amen. Thank you, Deacon Craig Stash, for bringing us back, taking us to the 80s, to the 70s, 80s, and 90s. We thank God for that rendition. Thank you, Father. Now, we continue our spotlight on Montenegro Black-owned businesses by our very own Sister Natasha V. Sally.
Trustee Natasha, Brother James Edwards must follow, and then Pastor.
Sorry about that. A storyteller by Brother James Brown.
Edwards.
Brother James Edwards, sorry.
Oh, well. Kurt Franken Revolution. Kurt Franken found a way to express the trial and tribulation of the world today through his music by reaching the young youth by singing gospel with the hip hop and R&B melody. His music is uplifting, giving us a message and the people to have faith. And he lets us know where to find it because revolution is coming. He does this by expressing where to find it. Chapter 7, Revelations, verse 16 and 17. No more hunger, no more sickness. Come on, let's be happy because a revolution is coming. God is going to wipe away everyone's pain. Kurt Franken expresses to young men and old men to get their act right, stop making children not being around, all the backstabbing, the crimes, the two-facedness, lying, will all pass away. A revolution is coming. Kurt Franken is Black history.
Amen. Amen.
What's Going On by Marvin Gaye. The song started as a party, but became something else. Something much more closer to a prayer. The time in there talks about the pain and heartache in the community, racism and drug abuse. He says in the beginning of the song, mother, mother, there's so many of you crying. Brother, brother, there's so many of you dying. He was saying it's not just whites killing blacks, it's us killing us. And mothers are crying because their sons are dying. Don't punish me with brutality. Talk to me so you can see what's going on. He's saying what's going on in the community and in the world of Vietnam War in 1971. So people could come together and unity to help. From neglected ghettos to thriving communities, churches, and to the abuse environment. It wasn't jazz or pop. It wasn't protest music. It wasn't pure gospel, but it definitely had that spirit. Marvin Gaye is Black history.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you for that, Brother James Edwards. Now, we will hear from our shepherd who needs no introduction. He is very relevant, bold, and courageous, who seeks excellence, our very own distinguished senior pastor, Reverend Dr. Johnny Melvin Green, Jr. Amen.
Come on, everybody, put your virtual hands together and give God some serious praise in the virtual worship experience today. This is the day the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. The psalmist said, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. This is a high and holy day. Our God is great. Our God is greatly to be praised, from the rising of the sun until the going down of the same. We are tremendously blessed today to have with us the awesome Attorney General of the Empire State of New York in the person of Attorney General Letitia James. She's a bad mother, shut your mouth. And we are extremely proud of her. And we're grateful to God that she is in this position for such a time as this. She is a woman of God. She is a freedom fighter. She is an activist. She fights for justice and equality on a daily basis. But most importantly, she represents us well in Albany as the top law official in the state of New York. And listen, she's a mover. She's a shaker. But I'm glad to call her friend. I'm glad to call her my sister. We've worked together on many projects. We've marched together. We've done so many things on behalf of our community together. But she is distinguished. She is a Attorney General par excellence. And I want her to come now, and I want her to bring greetings. I want her to let the Lord lead her in whatever way she feels as she shares. Let us put our virtual hands together for the baddest Attorney General in these United States of America, Attorney General Letitia James.
Thank you. First, I want to give honor to God this morning, who is the head of my life and from whom all blessings flow. And I want to thank the angel of this great virtual church, a church, a physical church, and a church that allows us to gather virtually. And that is in the spirit and the body, the angel of this great church, Reverend Johnny Melvin Green, Jr. I thank him so much for all that he has done. I want to give a shout out also to James. He was great. Thank you, James Edwards. Yay. And Craig, thank you for rocking us this morning. I appreciate that. God bless you. And I want to bring you greetings from my church, Emmanuel Baptist Church. We're meeting in about 10 minutes. So I want to bring you greetings from Emmanuel Baptist Church over here in Brooklyn. Brooklyn is in the house. I'm the only one, so I better be quiet. That's all right. And I want to thank all of you. And I want to pray for all of you. I want to pray for you for your healing, for your strength, for the members of the congregation, for all of those who we've lost as a result from this pandemic over this past year. This pandemic has been particularly destructive. Our communities were hit really very, very, very hard. I know that this church had to send home a number of saints. And so we've got to continue to pray for our community. We've got to pray for our community because we've been hit by three pandemics, COVID-19, racial unrest, and political duress, which we put to an end with the new administration. We're also seeing a lot of economic turmoil as well. Most people of color, unfortunately, we've lost their jobs. We serve as essential workers. We serve in government. a significant number of people of color, unfortunately, are unemployed right now and struggling to put food on the table and pay their rent. And this pandemic has woven itself into every aspect of our lives, from how our children learn, to how we conduct businesses, to how we treat our neighbors, to the mask that we wear on our face, and to how we worship our God each and every day. But, you know, I believe in God, and I believe the end is coming near, and I believe that we will be on the other side of this mountain very, very soon. And when we come out on the other side of the mountain, we're going to come out stronger and more united more than ever, fighting for change and for justice and for criminal justice reform and for police reform and for building up our communities and making this a better world, a better society for individuals like Mr. James Edwards, so that he one day can grow up and be a leader and lead us all going forward. The pandemic has kept us physically apart, but we know that technology and all of us in prayer will keep us together. And that relentless spirit to stay strong and support one another has never been needed now more than ever. And that's why I've come here today to say that in order for us to overcome this pandemic, we all have to get vaccinated. In order for us to get beyond this pandemic, 80% have to be vaccinated. And I recognize that we've got to have an honest discussion about race and the intersection of medical experimentation in the sad history of this country. We all know that there have been a number of experiments on people of color, on African Americans in particular, over the years, and particularly Black men. But we also need to understand that this vaccine, there's been a number of trials, and the number of trials that have involved people of color, have involved Black men, have involved Black women, have involved a significant number of individuals. We also know that there were doctors who were involved in this vaccination, both in the Pfizer and Moderna periods, that were Black doctors. And so I trust this vaccine. And that's why I'm waiting until my turn to get that vaccine. And it's important that all of us get vaccinated. And that's why I am so honored that your pastor and other great men and women of God have stepped up to talk about the efficacy and the safety of this vaccination. History has shown us an ugly side of society, and our instincts to be wary of such widespread efforts are not unfounded. But saints, these times are different. And if you're eligible to receive the COVID-19 vaccine, you should absolutely get vaccinated. Those who are pregnant should not get it. Those under a certain age should not get it. Those with pre-existing conditions should check with their doctors. That's really important. And the sooner we are vaccinated, the sooner we can begin the process of healing to repair the damage that has been wrought by this awful disease. As soon as we can bring back our economy, we can go back to work, we can pass the infrastructure bill, we can get more stimulus, we can send our children back to school, we can demand change in the criminal justice system and in policing. We can ensure that we will hold the Biden administration accountable and make sure that they do all that they promised to do, given the fact that we came out and vote in record numbers. And so it's important to know that, I fully support this vaccination, and we'll take the vaccine and we'll probably do it on television. And I also want you to know that my office has been at the forefront of working with the Cuomo administration to ensure that there is an eviction moratorium so that individuals are not evicted from their homes, that there's a foreclosure moratorium, that homes will not be foreclosed upon, that there's a tax lien moratorium. We have worked with the Cuomo administration to make sure that all of that is put in place. We've also made sure, and we have been in conversations with the Cuomo administration and the de Blasio administration that any budget in the city and the state of New York not be balanced on the backs of poor people and people of color, that the first order of business to ensure that people of color are put to work and reach and trained, and that the vaccination sites are equitably distributed all over this state. In addition to that, I've taken action against those I call bottom feeders who prey upon seniors and other vulnerable populations who want to sell you all kind of fake cures, lotions and potions, people who are advertising that they got all kind of cures to COVID when it's nothing but fake news. We've taken action, we've removed their websites, we've taken them down, and we will take any action against any individual in the state of New York who engages in fraud and or deception. We've also, again, canceled the collection of student loan and medical debt that's owed to the state of New York. That is also very critically important. But more importantly, it's important that all of us as children of God show compassion to our neighbors and that we reach out to one another during this time and check on our neighbors and particularly senior citizens. And I also want to thank your pastor for calling me because I needed it when I issued that nursing home report. It was important that I issue that report and speak truth to power. And it was important that we indicate the numbers of individuals who died in nursing homes. So I thank them. I thank each and every one of you. I hope all of you have some comfort in knowing that your Attorney General is working 24 hours, 7 days a week. I know that I represent each and every one of you. And I know that I would never do anything to embarrass any of you. And so continue to pray for my strength. And if you pray for me, I will pray for you. And I will pray for this great church. And I hope that one day soon and very soon, I will see you in person. We are in this together. And with the fortitude and strength provided by our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, we're gonna get over this. I know that because I, just like you, believe in a powerful force, more powerful than government, more powerful than municipalities and principalities, but our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, who sits high and looks low. God bless you and thank you. And thank you, Pastor.
All right. Let's put our virtual hands together and celebrate and serenade our great Attorney General. She's on fire for the Lord. She's a mighty woman of God. She's an amazing person. She's awesome. God has gifted her. God has given her wisdom and knowledge, and God has placed her as the Attorney General in the Empire State for such a time as this. I do not know a more fairer Attorney General or fairer person than our Attorney General, Letitia James. And I want to say this, and I don't venture too far out on the edge of prophecy, but here's what I'm going to say. Eyes have not seen, neither have ears heard, nor have it entered into the hearts of men what great things God has in store for Letitia James. You haven't seen nothing yet. I'm telling you, you watch me, you mark my word, you have not seen anything yet. When she was the public advocate, she did so many wonderful things on behalf of the citizens of New York City. And now she is the highest ranking law enforcement official in the state of New York. And she takes her job seriously. And this is what I love about her. In spite of her busy schedule, she has never gotten too busy for God. And I will tell you this, I know her pastor personally. He's a personal friend of mine. We've traveled together. A few years ago, we traveled to the country of Guatemala and spent a week together in Guatemala. She's active in her church. She's not just on the road. She just doesn't call Emmanuel her church home. And that's what I love about Letitia James. She's a woman of God, and she's somebody that we can trust, and she's somebody that we can believe in. So God bless you, Madam Attorney General, and may God keep you. And we cover you as members of Mount Nebo. We cover you in prayer. I believe we'll have a selection and then we'll come back and have our offering. Is that right, Reverend Baker?
Brother Pastor, we just, you wanted us to highlight the business owners.
Oh, that's right. My bad.
So Trustee Natasha will come at this time to present that.
Let's give Trustee Natasha Dazzler a virtual hand clap of praise. She's doing an awesome job today. God bless you.
Thank you, Pastor. And thank you also, Attorney General Letitia James, for stopping by for us today. Now we continue our spotlight on Montenegro Black-owned businesses by our very own Sister Natasha V. Sally.
Good morning. Montenegro Baptist Church celebrating their own with a special presentation, Who's Who in Business. Sister Betty Holland, Betty's Catering Service, handling all catering needs for anniversaries, birthdays, cookouts, retirements, you name it. Sister Ebony Thompson, Uppercuts Cupcakes, baking services. Trustee Janice House, Avon Ambassador. Brother Jeremiah Green, Greenhouse Recording Studio. Pastor Johnny M. Green Jr. and First Lady Jacqueline Green, Agape Children's Academy of New Jersey. Brother Joshua Green, Inner Circle Pictures Production Company. Ladies of Creations Party Decorating Service, Sister Carolyn Jones, Sister Ebony Thompson, Sister Karen Clemens, Sister Tia Randall. Sister Lily Powell, Lily Mae's Cakes. Sister Natasha V. Sally, NDS Consultations and Services, LLC, One Business, Service and Party Planning and Decorating, and Legal Documents and Resume Writing. This is my season to reward. Trustee Natasha Dansler, South Carolina Heating and Fuel, The Good Oil People, delivering number 2 heating oil. Trustee Natasha Dansler, Charles Ruttenberg Realty Company, licensed real estate professional handling Manhattan, Harlem, Bronx, and Westchester County. Sister Nia Mensa, Fasudi International, provides local and international medical, educational, and rehabilitation services. Sister Nia Mensa, Purpose Driven Physical Therapy, LLC, private physical therapy company providing personal training and health and wellness services. Sister Aura Little, Avon representative for over 40 years. Trustee Serena Mapson Oliver, Charles Ruttenberg Realty Incorporated, licensed real estate agent, handles all of New York State. Sister Sarah M. Lemon, Avon representative. Sister Sunky Shana Cornegay, Frizzell's Famous Pound Cake. Sister Tasia Sullivan, Venusian Beauty, makeup artist. Minister Troy Gortman, reviving floors and walls, carpenter and painter, floor and wall doctor, to your rescue. Sister Tina McCray, licensed real estate agent, Wally Realty. Residential and commercial co-ops and condos, sales, rentals, appraisals, mortgages, foreclosures, apartment building management. Black history is recognizing our own, one business at a time. Thank you.
Amen, amen. We thank God for that. We thank you for showcasing our members and their businesses. And we know that it's being Black and being in business, it's a struggle, but we thank God for those that are on the storefronts and doing what they're supposed to do. So glory to God and handling your business. We thank you for that. And thank you, Pastor and Reverend Baker, for showcasing, allowing us to showcase this as well, as long as Natisha V. Sally. We will now have our sermonic selection by our very own, again, Natisha V. Sally.
Not before I take up this offer.
I know that's right, Pastor. I'm sorry. You are so right. Go ahead on, my Pastor. Do what you do best. Thank you.
Thank you, Trustee Natasha Dazzler. You have done an awesome job today, and we celebrate you in the way that you have allowed the Lord to use you for this service to flow. It's been flowing. And I'm really appreciative for all of the hats that you wear around the church as vice chair lady of our trustee ministry. You have so provided oil, you and your family have been the provider of oil for our church. Down through the years, we've been able to depend on you and your company for the maintenance of our boiler and all sorts of services. Major repairs that we've had to do around the church. But most importantly, you are a child of God. And I appreciatively applaud you and celebrate you today as our worship leader. It is time for us to receive the Lord's tithe and to give our offering. And you know, Mount Nebo, I'm normally never at a loss of words. But I am almost at a loss of words because you have exceeded all expectations. We've broken all kinds of financial records during this period of pandemic. And, you know, I give all of the praise, all of the glory and the honor to God. To God be the glory for the great things that he has done. And he's certainly done great things. Nobody can take credit. I certainly cannot take credit for all that God has done, is doing, and all that God will do. And so you have just been stellar members when it came down to supporting our church. And that's why we've chosen to use our beautiful sanctuary as our backdrop, because it still looks the same. God has blessed us with our upkeep, and we would not have been able to do it without your support, without your help. We just cannot do this. And I want you to know that we need all hands on deck. We need all hands on deck. And no amount is too small. And I was going through my personal mail this morning, and I received some gifts from Sister Reddick, who lives on Fifth Avenue. And you know what? She sent it to Manna, but I'm giving it to the church. It's a small amount, but you know what? It's going to the church because God is just good. God is just good. I think about how our millennials showed up on yesterday and showed out in support of the manna feeding, along with the Pan-African student body from St. John's University. Minister Maya did an awesome job yesterday in leading the millennials. And we were able to feed, Reverend Sandra Baker, we were able to feed more than 300 people and families. We were able to feed, yes, that's a whole lot of feeding. And I was out on the streets myself, passing out food. And I'm going to tell you, the people who were the recipients of that were very appreciative. I saw things yesterday on 125th and Lenox that I'd never seen before. Not that I live in an isolated world, but I've never seen it at that level. I've seen degradation. I've seen hurt. I've seen pain. I've seen suffering. I've seen drug addiction, but I've never seen it at that level before. And so I'm thankful and I'm appreciative to our millennials for the WIN ministry under the leadership of Minister Maya Clark. And I'm grateful for Tasia Sullivan and the group from St. John and Sister Antonia Griffin. Thank you. Yeah, I appreciate you all. I love you all. You all love the Lord. And it's just good to see young people. So let's support our church, because when you give to the ministry, you enable the church and the ministry to continue being a blessing to the community. And church has to be more than maintenance. And what I mean by that is that church has to be more than paying salaries and paying utility bills and paying mortgage payments and paying insurances and paying for the general upkeep of a building. Church has to be involved in carrying the gospel message of Jesus Christ to the world and helping those who are hurting. So when you give to the church, and we need a good offering today. We need a good offering today. I'm telling you, I would like to receive a record-breaking offering today for the third Sunday in February. I would like for us to receive a record-breaking. I want you to give today. I want everyone to pay your tithe and your offerings. Pay your tithe. You know, you can't be God-given no matter how hard you try, because the more God gives to you, the more you give to him, the more he will give back to you. Good measures pressed down, shaken together, and running over shall men give into your bosom. So give God his tithe. Pay the tithe. The tithe belongs to the Lord. And then give an offering. Give a generous offering. Sow a seed today. And as you are sowing seed, I want you to watch God meet each and every one of your needs. God has promised. I said God has promised to supply all of our need according to his riches in glory. There are several ways to give. You can give through Givelify, Mount Nebo Baptist Church on Givelify. You can Zelle your offering, MTNEBOH at AOL.com. You can mail your donations to 1883 Adam Clayton Powell Jr. Boulevard, New York, New York, 10026. You can drop your offering off by the church Tuesday through Friday, 10 a.m. to 2 p.m. and 5 p.m. to 9 p.m. And our Cash App is back. Our Cash App is back. And you can Cash App us. I believe it is $MTNEBOH BC 1883. Did I get it right?
Yes.
That's MTNEBOH BC 1883. I heard Sister Cooper give it this morning and it registered in my memory bank. So I want you to give today. There is no reason why you cannot deliver the Lord's tithe and offerings to the church. And listen, your tithe, I have to say this. I'm mandated to say this. I must say this. It's imperative that I say this. Your tithe and your offering are at work. And Trustee Helen Simmons and the Trustee Ministry, they are working on something so big this year. Listen, it's going to blow your mind, but they can't do it and they can't accomplish it without your support. Mount Nebo, I want to give all of you all a big, big, colossal and virtual hug this morning. And I want you to know that God loves you and Pastor Green loves you. God bless you and God keep you is our prayer. We'll now have a selection.
Hallelujah, salvation and glory, honor and power unto the Lord our God. For the Lord our God is mighty. Yes, the Lord our God is omnipotent. The Lord our God, He is one. Therefore,
come on, everybody, to the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Salvation and glory.
Salvation and glory.
I dare you to sing it.
Honor and power.
Unto the Lord our God. I don't care what everybody else says. The Lord our God is mighty.
The Lord our God is mighty.
Yes, the Lord our God is omnipotent.
The Lord our God is omnipotent.
The Lord our God, He's wonderful.
The Lord our God,
yes, He is.
He is
one. Put it in your spirit. Let's release it in the atmosphere. Everybody to Jesus. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Salvation and glory.
Salvation and glory.
Honor and power, everybody.
Honor and power.
Unto the Lord our God. That's it. Make it a song for your heart to sing. For the Lord our God.
Yes, the Lord our God.
Yes, the Lord our God. To the Lord our God. He is wonderful. Where are the outsoles? Come on, outsoles. All praises to the King of Kings. Yes. And the Lord our God. It is wonderful. Where are the soprano singers? Come on, just sing to the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. All the sinners, come on, with a voice of victory. Hallelujah. Salvation and glory. Honor and power. He is wonderful. Everybody, everybody, come on, come on, tonight. Make it glorious, make it glorious.
Salvation and glory.
Wow. Anybody who has ever had an experience with God will know that he is wonderful. Our God is an awesome God, isn't he? Our God is a great God. He's great and greatly to be praised from the rising of the sun until the going down of the same. I want to say how deliciously proud I am to be your pastor. You all have made me a very proud, excited, and a happy pastor. And thank you for the joy, Manibo, that you bring into my life, being the wonderful congregation that you are. I just personally believe, and I'm biased, that I pastor the greatest church on planet Earth, not this side of the Hudson or that side of the Hudson, but I believe that I am privileged to pastor the greatest church this side of heaven. And I want to celebrate you. You all always celebrate me. You're always doing great things for me. You're always saying kind things about me. And let me tell you something. I could not be who I am, and I could not do what I do if it were not for the support that I receive from you. And I'll always be on the front lines. I'll always stand up for justice and equality. I'll always try to bring you the best word from the Lord. I'll always try to provide five-star leadership to our congregation. And I will continue to surround myself with leaders who are stellar, leaders who are committed, and leaders who are faithful, and leaders who love God. You deserve that. You deserve that. And so I just wanted to get that out of the way. I just wanted to say that because my heart rejoices today. My heart rejoices today over the victory, I saw so many of you out yesterday. So many of our members came out to support, and you went to the streets. You took food to people who were hungry. And you know, that is our responsibility, to feed the hungry. Our job, there's going to come a time when the Lord is going to be judging, and he's going to say, you saw me hungry and you didn't feed me. Well, that's one thing we don't have to worry about. The Lord will say, when you saw me hungry, you fed me. And so I'm just thankful again. I want to celebrate our millennials. I want to celebrate the young people from St. John, and I want to celebrate the membership. Reverend Baker, thank you for all that you do. And man, to God be the glory. God gets all of the glory. Let me go ahead and get in this word. I won't be long today, but I do plan on being strong. There is a word from the Lord, and I want to preach today. My sermon title today is The Real Deal. The Real Deal. Wherever you are, just say virtually, wherever you are in a room with somebody else, in a room by yourself, just say, our pastor is preaching today a sermon entitled The Real Deal. And I want to thank James Edwards. Man, you blessed my heart when you broke it down. You broke it down, brother. When you talked about Marvin Gaye, and I want you to know, when you mentioned Marvin Gaye, Marvin Gaye is Pastor Green's favorite R&B artist. I listen to Marvin Gaye more than I listen to James Brown. I listen to Marvin Gaye more than I listen to Michael Jackson. I listen to to Marvin Gaye more than I listened to The Temptations. I want you to know Marvin Gaye was one of my favorite artists, and you blessed me today, and you broke it down, you explained how the music evolved and the message behind the music. Man, you were powerful, and your brothers that are with you, man, I celebrate y'all. I honor y'all. I appreciate y'all. And I want you to know my virtual arms are around you, and we're in the struggle together. I'm with you. You know, I'm gonna keep it 100 with you, but I'm with you 100. And I love y'all, man. I just wanted to publicly. And Craig Stagg, listen, man, you bless my heart today. You bless my heart today. We all know that you're gifted. We all know that you're talented. And it's a poor dog that won't wag his own tail. We have a lot of gifts and a lot of talent in Mount Nebo Baptist Church. And then the business owners, exclude me. But all those business owners in our church, I'm praying for you. I'm praying that your business will be a success. I'm praying that God will do great things with you as an entrepreneur. And I want you to know that the services that you provide are very important services. So I'm praying for you. I'm praying for my sons. My sons are in business. My oldest son has opened up his recording studio in Lyndhurst, New Jersey. And then my youngest son has partnered with his business partner, and they are the proprietors of Inner Circle Production Pictures. And I'm just proud of them. I'm proud of them, and I'm proud of the work that Sister Green does at Agape every day as the day-to-day business manager and operator. She makes it happen, and I'm appreciative to God for her for that. I just rest on my laurels. I want you to know, as the president and founder, I just rest on my laurels. I put my time in, let everybody else do the work, and let me get the glory. Come on, give God a hand of praise. Give God a hand of praise. Give God a hand of praise. Let's go into the word. I thought that would get you, Reverend Baker. Sankashana, I thought that would kind of shake Reverend Baker up. I did my time, and now I'm resting on my laurels. So let me get into the word of God. Romans chapter 3, with a specific focus on verse 23. But I'm going to read for your hearing Romans chapter 3, verses 23, and I'll read down to verse 28 from the New Living Translation. It's going to bless your life. I'm telling you, it's going to bless your life and the way you think about the gospel as we go forth. For everyone has sinned. We all fall short of God's glorious standard. The King James Version said, for all have sinned and do come short of the glory of God. Verse 24, yet God freely and graciously declares that we are righteous. He did this through Christ Jesus when he freed us from the penalty for our sins. Verse 25, for God presented Jesus as the sacrifice for sin. People are made right with God when they believe that Jesus sacrificed his life, shedding his blood. This sacrifice shows that God was being fair when he held back and did not punish those who sinned in times past. For he was looking, verse 26, ahead and including them in what he would do in the present time. God did this to demonstrate his righteousness, for he himself is fair and just, and he declares sinners to be right in his sight when they believe in Jesus. Can we boast then that we have done anything to be accepted by God? No, because our acquittal is not based on obeying the law, it is based on faith. So we are made right with God through faith and not by obeying the law. Herein is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be unto God. Today's message is entitled The Real Deal. And I would ask everyone to mute your phones, if you would, mute your devices. The real deal. You know, there comes a point in time when people need to know the truth. The Bible reminds us that ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. A lot of people, Reverend Sandra Baker, are resistant to the truth. They don't want to hear the truth. They do not want to be a recipient of the truth. A lot of people, I want you to know, Sister Serena Mapson, a lot of people are deceptive to them on, towards their own selves. A lot of people do not accept the truth about who they are. A lot of people do not accept the truth about where they are in their walk with God, where they are in their relationship with other people. People are just sometimes resistant of the truth. And here's the real deal. The real deal is sometimes people are more receptive of a lie than they are the truth. As we've seen in the outgoing administration of Donald J. Trump, it seems that the more lies he told, the more populated his following became. His crowd mushroomed. His crowd of followers grew and grew. The more lies he told, the more people latched on. The more lies he told, the more people bought into this political philosophy that we now know as Trumpism. The more lies he told about his opponents, and even sometimes people who stood as his allies, the more committed his followers became. You know, he coined the idea or the term fake news, but he was the greatest perpetrator of fake news of all time. But in spite of all of the fake news, in spite of all of the lies that he told, he amassed a following that ultimately on January 6th, based upon his lies, based upon his false information, they stormed and attacked the citadel of our democracy, the United States Capitol. That is a day that will go down as one of the worst days in American history. And it was all based on a lie. It was not factual. It was not the real deal. Let me say something to you, brothers and sisters. It's one thing to get things wrong politically, but it's another thing to get things wrong religiously and spiritually. When it comes down to the Word of God, when it comes down to our relationship with God, when it comes down to our salvation, we need to know the truth. We need to know the real deal. And that's what the Apostle Paul is doing here in this passage. The Apostle Paul here in this passage is sharing with the Roman Christians the real deal. You know, in chapters 1, Paul talked about the gospel and the purpose of the gospel. He talked about him. He described himself as a preacher of the gospel. He described the gospel as good news, and the gospel is good news because the gospel tells us that Jesus Christ has died on the cross for our sins and that we might have a right to the tree of life if we accept and receive Jesus. If we confess with our mouth and believe in our heart that God has raised Christ from the dead, we shall be saved. Then Paul went on to talk about sin and wickedness. And Paul spent the entirety of chapter 2, Natisha B. Sally, talking about sin. Sin is missing the mark. Sin is falling short of the ideals of God. Sin is going in the opposite direction of righteousness. But not only did he spend the duration of chapter 2 talking about sin, Tina McCray, he also talked about wickedness. And we need to know that there is a difference between sin and wickedness. Let me tell you something. All of us are sinners. And I said this earlier this week in the Manna for Your Morning. We are all naughty by nature. We're naughty by nature because the Bible says we were born in sin and we were shapen in iniquity. And Dr. Calvin Rice, Bishop Calvin Rice of the New Jerusalem Worship Center in Jamaica, Queens, helped me with the distinguishable characteristics of sin and wickedness and the difference between sin and wickedness. He says wickedness is sin on steroid. Wickedness is when we take something in its natural form and we pervert it and we use it in a very unnatural way. That's when sin becomes wickedness. Now, I don't have time to talk about that because I want to get to the meat of the message of what we're talking about today in Romans chapter 3. Now, the first thing that we need to know is that in spite of our sins, get this, don't miss this, Tasia Sullivan, please, Ebony Thompson, please, Tina McCray, please, Sankashana Carnegie, please don't ever forget this. In spite of all our sins, in spite of all of our unrighteousness, I want you to get this, Trustee Natasha Danzler. I want you to understand unequivocally that Paul, in the first 8 verses, reminds the Romans that God is faithful. That's the only way you can sum up Romans chapter 3, the first 8 verses, is simply by saying that God is faithful. We are not faithful. And Paul lays it out in his argument with the Jews and the Gentiles, because sometimes the Jews saw themselves as privileged. Sometimes the Jews saw themselves better than others. But nothing is further from the truth. Paul points out that Jews are sinners and Gentiles are sinners. That includes everybody. But in spite of our sin, in spite of our sins, in spite of our unrighteousness, God remains faithful. Somebody ought to shout hallelujah this morning that God remains faithful. And against the backdrop of teaching us that God remains faithful, Paul spent verses 9 through 20 describing all as sinners. All people are sinners. Don't miss that, Nia. Don't miss that, Ebony Thompson. James, don't miss that. I don't want you to miss that, Sister Aura Little. I don't want you to miss that, Deacon Bradley Howard, Deacon Richard White, Deacon Lamont Duke. I don't want you to miss the fact, Sister Marquita, Deaconess Marquita Howard. All people are sinners. That's right. Everybody in the church are sinners. Now, here's the deal. Your sins may not be my sins, and my sins may not be your sins. But Sister Sarah Usher, I've got to tell you the truth this morning, Sister Sarah Lemon. All of us are sinners. And verse 9 through 20, Paul spends the duration of those verses describing all as sinners. We are all sinners. Listen, you don't have the right to judge anybody. You don't have the right to look down on anybody. It doesn't matter what work you're involved in the church, or what work you're not involved in. It doesn't matter how many times you visit the church. It doesn't matter how many times you pray. It doesn't matter how much money you give. It doesn't matter what position or what title you hold in the church. Paul says that all people are sinners. Now, here's where it gets good, because we're getting to the point where I want to talk about the real deal. In verse 21, Paul really wants the Roman Christians to know, in a succinct summary, Reverend Sandra Baker, that we are justified by our faith. It is your faith that saves you, not your good works, not how many people you pray for, not how many lunch meals you give out on the corner of 125th Street and Lexington. It's not about how many songs you lead in the choir. It's not about how many sermons I preach behind the sacred desk at 1883 Adam Clayton Power Jr. Boulevard. It's not about how many fasts you go on. It's not about how many consecrations you go on. You need to understand the reason why we are saved is because Christ took on our punishment. And that's where I want you to drop anchor in verse 21, because it's in verse 21 that Paul begins a thorough discussion about Christ taking on our punishment. Look at what verse 21 said. Now, Paul has already proven that God is faithful. Paul has already proven that we are all sinners, all people, all races, all nationalities, all ethnicities, it all across cultural boundaries. All people are sinners. Red, yellow, black, and white, all are sinners. And here's what Christ did for sinners. Verse 21, but now God has shown us a way to be made right with him without keeping the requirements of the law, as was promised in the writings of Moses and the prophets long ago. See, the Jews thought that they could be saved through the law, but they failed at every turn, at every point. Tia Randall, they fail at every, because none could keep the law. And so as opposed to being saved by the law, what they didn't understand was that the law only exposed their sin and made them aware of their sin. But then verse 22 comes, he said, we are made right with God by placing our faith in Jesus Christ. I'm giving you the real deal, because I don't want you to think that you will get to heaven by coming to church. A lot of people are going to go to hell straight through the church. Do I have a witness here? A lot of people are going to go to hell straight through the pulpit. A lot of people are going to go to hell straight through the choir stand. A lot of people are going to go to hell even after being an usher for 30, 40, 50 years, because they do not understand that salvation is not in us, but salvation is something granted to us by the Lord. We are made right with God by placing our faith in Jesus Christ. And this is true for everyone who believes, no matter who we are, no matter where we are, no matter what we are involved in. Here's what verse 23 says. And here's the real deal. The real deal is we are all sinners. Somebody say that with me. I am a sinner. Somebody write that in the chat box on social media. I am a sinner. See, you can't get right with God until you acknowledge that you are wrong with God. Oh, somebody ought to put that in the chat box. You can't get right with God until you recognize and acknowledge that you are wrong with God. You see, you can't get medical help until you acknowledge that there is a problem in your body. You will never be able to cure your pain, being in denial of your pain. You will never be cured of a sickness by denying that you are sick. And all of us, watch this, Sister Carnegie, watch this, Tina McCray, all of us are infected with sin. The real deal is we have to confront our sins. Look at what verse 23 said. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. I know you thought you were all right. I know you thought you were in the safety zone. I know you thought, because you didn't drink hard liquor, or because you never got strung out on drugs, or because you never went to the nightclub, and because you never went in the nightclub and bagged that thing up and dropped it like it was hot. I know you thought you were in the safety zone, but I've got to tell you, with your unsanctified self, all have sinned. Everybody in the church has sinned. The preacher has sinned. The deacon has sinned. The president of the auxiliary has sinned. The president of the choir has sinned. The president of the usher board, the nurses unit. Come on, somebody. The piano player, the organ player, the sound man. All have sinned. And so the first thing, as we deal with the real deal, we have to acknowledge is our sin. Listen to what Paul said, verse 23, for all have sinned, and because all have sinned, we fall short. I don't know about anybody else, but Tasia Sullivan, it breaks my heart when I fall short. I try to do the very best that I can on a daily basis. I try to the best of my ability, Deacon Lamont Duke. I try to be the very best morally person that I can be. But I've got to tell you that even my most righteous deeds are as filthy rags. I don't want you to miss this, Sister Nia Mensah. I don't want you to miss this, Sister Sharon Lemon. I don't want you to miss this. Even my most righteous deeds are as filthy rags in the eyesight of the Lord. Anybody here besides Pastor Green, you ever take two steps forward and it seems like as soon as you take two steps forward, you end up making three steps backwards? You know what? That's because Paul talked about it later on in Romans, and we'll get to it someday, where Paul said, there's a law warring in my members. He said, when I try to do good, evil is always present. I wonder why. Even when I say to myself, I'm going to live holy. Even when I say to myself, I'm going to live righteous. Even when I say to myself, I'm going to spiritually dot every I and spiritually cross every T. Even when I say to myself, Minister Gerald Aiken, that I'm going to live my best life for Christ, I find myself falling short. Here's the deal. You know what? All of us have said to ourselves at some point, I can't believe I did that. I can't believe I went there again. I can't believe that I reverted back to ways that I thought I was delivered from. You know why that is? It's because it is sin within us. The people that you think are so bad, they are not so bad. It's the sin in the people that's bad. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. So when we talk about the real deal first confronts us in the area of our sin. But then secondly, between verses 24 and 26, not only do we see our sin, we see our Savior. Listen, without Jesus Christ, I'm hopeless. Without Jesus Christ, I would be on my way to hell with no God on my side. I'm already too mean to live and unfit to die. If it were not for the Savior, somebody shout, our Savior. If it were not for our Lord and Savior, we would lift up our eyes in hell. And I want you to know, hell is real. Judgment Day is coming. Hell is real, but we're going to escape hell because we have put our faith in our Savior. I told you about our sins. I told you we're naughty by nature. I told you all have sinned. I told you all do fall short of the glory of God. But the good news of the gospel is every sinner has a Savior if you would just open up your heart. Here's what the Savior has done for you. Yet God, here it is, freely and graciously declares that we are righteous. He did this through Christ Jesus when he freed us from the penalty of our sin. See, when we think about the Savior declares us righteous even when we're sinful. Oh man, that blows my mind, Reverend Sandra Baker, that the Savior declares me righteous. I don't want you to miss this. Even when I'm sinful, I know, listen, I know I don't, you don't need anybody to tell you that you're a sinner. You don't need to tell anybody to tell you that you're wrong. You don't need anybody to tell you that you're stubborn. You don't need to people to tell you that you have a bad disposition, that you have a bad attitude, that you have some terrible ways, that you engage in behavior that's not becoming of God, because you already know that, because your conscience testifies against you. But listen, even with your sinful, wicked, dirty, unrighteous self, God makes us righteous through the blood of Jesus. How do I get cleaned up? I'm glad you're asking good questions. I'm a sinner. How do I get cleaned up? Our Savior cleans us up. Look at what verse 25 says. For God presented Jesus as the sacrifice for sin. What does that mean? I'm glad you all are asking some good questions. That means that God sent Jesus Christ to that old rugged cross to die on that cross in your place. Jesus didn't deserve what happened to him, but Jesus paid it all. Oh, hallelujah. Somebody type in the chat box, Jesus paid it all, and all to him I owe. Sin has left a crimson stain, but he washed me white as snow. How did he do it? He became a sacrifice for our sin. And people are made right with God when they believe that Jesus sacrificed his life. Here's what he did, shedding his blood. The Bible says, without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sin. This sacrifice shows that God was being fair when he held back and did not punish those who sinned in time. It may seem like God punished the wrong person. It may seem like the wrath of God fell on the wrong person, Antonia Griffin. Martha Foster Brown, it may seem like the wrath of God was issued out against the wrong. God allowed his wrath to fall on his own son so he could deliver us from the penalty of sin. Listen, I'm a sinner, but I have a Savior. And I want to give you the last piece about the real deal. When you look at verse 27 in the New Living Translation, it says, can we boast then that we have done anything to be accepted by God? And the resounding answer is no, because our acquittal, and I want you to underscore that word acquittal, is not based on obeying the law. It is based on faith. So listen to me. Here's what I want you to know. I want you to know the real deal. The real deal, you are a sinner. The real deal is you fall short. The real deal is that even your most righteous deeds are as filthy rags in his eyesight. The real deal is the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. You're a sinner. You're dirty. You're wretched. You're undone. And like Paul, when you would do good, evil is always present. So don't start celebrating too fast. You know, Carl Washington, pastor of New Mount Zion Baptist Church in Harlem, New York, and president of the Empire Baptist Missionary State Convention. He tells this story about a time when he played football at Ohio State for the legendary coach, Woody Hayes. And he said he remembered one game that they scored a touchdown. The Ohio State Buckeyes scored a touchdown. And they started celebrating in the end zone. They started celebrating after the touchdown in the end zone. And after they celebrated, they looked over to the sideline and they saw that Coach Hayes was not celebrating, that he was not in a celebratory mode. And he called them all. He signaled all of them to come to the sideline. He said, I don't know why you all are dancing and why you all are celebrating in the end zone. You haven't won the game. You just scored a touchdown. There is still more football to play. Listen, I want you to know, just because you have not been condemned, just because you got saved yesterday, just because you are in the church, just because you have membership and discipleship, you have no reason to praise yourself. You have no reason to pat yourself on the back. You have no reason to start celebrating as if though you accomplished salvation on your own or by yourself. You don't have anything to boast about. You don't have anything to celebrate about other than you have been acquitted by God. You wasn't acquitted because you were innocent. Just like innocent people go to jail and do hard times for a crime that they did not commit. There are people who get off for crimes that they did commit. And I want you to know you fall in the second category. I fall in the second. That, listen, there are some people who are far better by nature than we are by practice, but they don't get acquitted because they are better by nature than we are by practice. There are some people like you and I who are guilty of every sin in the book. But guess what? Your sins have not condemned you, because when the judge, who is God, comes back with the verdict, he's not going to be looking at your sin. He's going to be looking at the blood of Jesus. And when the verdict comes in, it will come in an acquittal. Listen, I've got to leave you. I held you way too long. My time is out. Hasta la vista, baby. I've got to go now. But I want you to know the real deal is you are a sinner. The real deal is you fall short. The real deal is our Savior, Jesus Christ, came all the way from heaven down to earth to die on the cross for our sin. And as a result, we can say that we are saved. Listen, I'm saved by his power divine, saved to new life. Sublime, life now is free and my joy is complete, cause I'm saved. Can I say that one more time? I'm saved, I'm talking about the real deal now, by his power divine, saved to new life. Sublime, life now is sweet, and my joy is complete, cause I'm saved at the cross. At the cross where I first saw the light and the burdens of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. The real deal, you and I are sinners. The real deal is Jesus died in our place. The real deal is we're saved because we've been acquitted because of the blood of Jesus. Not of anything we've done on our own. We don't have boasting rights. We simply have a right to praise God for what God has done for us. And that's the real deal. Reverend Sandra Baker will open the doors of the church.
My God, thank you so much, Brother Pastor. I don't know about you, but he left us where we ought to rejoice. We ought to rejoice that we've been saved, despite the fact that we are sinners, despite the fact that we was on our way to hell. We thank God for the blood of Jesus. Thank you so much, Brother Pastor. I don't know about anybody else, but just thinking about the word of God and knowing that we're guilty, but thank God for Jesus. Thank you for the reminder, Pastor. None of us can declare that it's been because we've done anything good, but we can only declare the real deal is that Jesus paid it all, and all to him I owe. Anybody owe Jesus some praise right now? Anybody want to thank God for salvation today? Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I'm saved today. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. And today, Pastor just gave the message. He gave the call to discipleship. He gave the message today. Whoever's listening this morning, you have the opportunity to accept the real deal. I don't care what you've done. Pastor spoke personally. I can speak personally. I'm a sinner. We all can declare it. But today, he reminded us that Jesus paid the price. And today, you need to know that. Some man, some woman, some girl, you need to know that Jesus paid it all. He died so that you and I can accept his love for us. So today, if you're listening, I just want to share with you, I don't care what people have said about you. I don't care what you know about your past. Today, this word has indicated that you are no different than any of us. And you can choose Jesus today. We offer you Jesus. Out of everything that has been done today, this message was just for you. This message was just for me. This message was a reminder that we can't look above anyone, but we all need Jesus. Anybody can declare without Jesus, you would be lost. Anybody can declare that without Jesus, you and I would have lost our minds. But blessed be the name of the Lord that Jesus has paid the price for our sins. So this morning, if you're listening, we can't tell you how much our life has been different because we have accepted the Lord Jesus Christ into our hearts. We can't begin to tell you that Jesus will make a difference. Yes, you'll have some difficult days, but I tell you, I'd rather have Jesus in my life, through my trials, through my tribulations, than to be going through life by myself. And so today, if that's your desire to have Jesus in your life, to be in a relationship with him, we offer you Christ today. Or we offer you Mary's baby boy. We offer you the savior of the world. We invite you, if you're watching on Facebook, to go into the description box. There is a link that if you put your name, if you put your email, one of the staff members of this church will call you. They will pray with you. Pastor already gave you the plan of salvation. He spelled it out that all you have to do is make that decision. And if you make that decision, we will accept you into the Mount Nebo family. We will love up on you. We will walk with you in this life journey because we believe that we can't make it without Jesus. We believe that if you have Jesus in your life, he'll walk with you. He'll make your life brand new. Our prayer is today that you would allow Jesus to come into your heart. We pray that you would accept Christ and allow him to change your status. He'll change your story. He'll make your life brand new. God bless you is our prayer. Thank you, Pastor, for that word this morning.
God bless you, Reverend Baker. Thank you, Sister Natisha V. Sally, for the awesome music today and every Sunday that you provide for us. To God be the glory. I want to thank all of our worship participants. Certainly, we want to again celebrate our worship leader, trustee, Natasha Danzler. I want to thank each and every one of you. Don't forget to pay your tithe. Don't forget to give your offering. Don't forget to give sacrificially. Go to our website. Go to givelify.com. Look up Mount Nebo Baptist Church. You can Zelle your tithe and offerings, mtneboh @aol.com. You can Cash App your tithe and offerings to $ MTNEBOHBC1883, or you can mail your donations to 1883 Adam Clayton Powell Jr. Boulevard, New York, New York, 10026, or you can come by the church Tuesday through Friday between the hours of 10 and 2 and the hours of 5 and 9, and you will receive credit for your support of the ministry. We're in prayer. Let us remember to pray for the family of Sister Gladys Perry, her only surviving daughter. We want to pray for her. We want to pray for that family. And then we want to pray for the Ravenel family. Brother Irv Ravenel, the patriarch of the Ravenel family, has folded up his tent and he has gone upstairs to be with the Lord. And our hearts are splintered and split asunder. We are heartbroken, but earth has no sorrow that heaven cannot heal. I want you to lift up Sister Evelyn Ravenel in prayer. I want you to lift up Sister Debbie Ravenel and the entire Ravenel family, Kevin Ravenel Jr., Sister Evelyn Washington, our former member who's down in South Carolina, and Sister Mosley, her sister, Brother Ravenel's sister, who is the mother of late Minister Kathy Williams. They are all family. They are all brothers and sisters. And we certainly want to pray for them that God will heal their hurts. We don't have any funeral detail as of yet, but as soon as we receive it, we will get on the horn and on the wire and let you know, because we want to have a great homegoing celebration for Brother Irv Ravenel. We are loosening up our restrictions a little bit more. As time progresses, we'll loosen up our restrictions. But even in loosening up our restrictions and allowing more people to come to funerals, masks will be required. Masks will be required. And so we're going to loosen the restrictions a little bit more, and our services will be a little bit more extensive, because we want our members to have the kind of homegoing celebration that they deserve. Now, I want to say this one thing. I was very disappointed Thursday in what happened at Sister Perry's funeral. Sister Perry was an honorable woman. She was a Christian woman, and she was a church-going woman. And one of her nephews came in the church. He came in the church with a bottle of Crown Royal, a fifth of Crown Royal, had it tucked in his pocket. And when he came up to have remarks, he pulled out the whiskey bottle, broke the seal, and in honor of his aunt, took a swig. And I stopped him right there, took the mic out of his hand, made him sit down. And I began to scold him and to tell him that the church is not the place for this kind of behavior. Now, some of you may believe it's okay because some people don't know. But let me tell you something. The Bible tells us that our conscience reminds us, even if nobody has ever told you about God, even if you've never stepped foot in the church, everybody knows what the church represents. And it represents something otherworldly. And so, if you don't tell your family how to act before they come in, I will tell them how to act when they come in. We will not, if you have enough gall, unmitigated gall, to disrespect and to dishonor God, then I have enough unmitigated gall to humiliate you and embarrass you and to set you straight in the house of God. So tell your family when they come to God's house, to honor you, when they lay you out in front of that altar, tell them they better come correct. Though Pastor Green and the officers and members will give them an eviction notice and they'll never be able to come back in that particular building. Amen. Because the one thing that this pastor and this congregation will not do, we will not respect, we will not tolerate dishonor and disrespect of our God. Our God is a high and a holy God. Amen. God bless you. May heaven smile upon you. Don't forget power prayer call on Tuesday at 6:30 a.m. and 7:30 p.m. Don't forget our Bible enrichment on Wednesday evening. Men, don't forget that Brother Wade would like to meet with you. And if I've overlooked something, charge it to my head and not my heart. Reverend Baker, does anything else claim our attention?
Yes, Brother Pastor, just want to remind the partnership we have with the Department of Health. For those who are having trouble with the vaccine, they can contact Sister Queen, who's helping with registrations for the vaccine. Also, this Wednesday is the last Wednesday of the month, so we will be having our corporate prayer. And then again, Pastor, you mentioned you wanted to share something about the wonderful event that our deacons and trustee had on our relationships during the pandemic. Thank you.
All right. God bless you and may heaven smile upon you is our prayer. Now may the grace of God, the love of Jesus Christ, and the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit, may it rest, rule, and abide with us all, henceforth, now and forevermore. Let every heart say amen. God bless you and God bless you is our prayer.